very much, and it's great to be with you there. I'm sorry I can't actually be there physically. I would love to be in your beautiful city. It's one of my favorite cities to be in and to visit, and you're very fortunate to be able to be there. I wish I could be there with you, but instead I'll be using Zoom. So let me just tell you a little bit about this paper. And this paper comes about because several different people asked me to reflect on the question of what is the relationship between biblical Greek linguistics and questions of philosophy and hermeneutics. And so I've taken the occasion to write this paper, and I will be summarizing it for the 30, 35 minutes that we have. It's a longer manuscript, but I look forward to questions that you may wish to ask. Basically, the question that I'm going to ask comes about from the fact that in many ways, contemporary discussion is that, is in terms of separate disciplines that we have. But in this particular paper, I'm trying to ask the question of what is the relationship between Greek linguistics and philosophy and or hermeneutics, and what are the implications of this relationship? And of course, that's a huge question to ask, because it spans centuries and brings together several disciplines. So I'm going to have to speak in terms of a generalization and generalizations. And so I'll try to do that the best that I can. So a couple of general statements to begin. And the first one is that the way this is formulated in the question of biblical Greek linguistics, philosophy, hermeneutics, it may appear that language and linguistic study is something different from philosophical or hermeneutical discussion. But I really don't think that that's true. They're much more closely integrated than we typically think. And one of the results of discipline development within our fields is this kind of a silo effect, where we get isolated into various areas. And this paper is at least in part an attempt to deal with that siloing, overcome it in some ways. The second generalization is that questions of language have long been important questions that have preoccupied philosophers. And I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute, but questions of language are often tied up with questions of philosophy. The third generalization is that philosophy and hermeneutics are not two separate disciplines, but hermeneutics is probably best seen as a subdiscipline of philosophy, perhaps even a subtopic within the field of epistemology, of how we know things, how we understand things. So a little bit of a brief history then of Greek linguistics in relationship to philosophy and hermeneutics. I divide the history of Greek linguistics, as many people do, into sort of three periods, from the Enlightenment to the present. And those three periods are the rationalist, the comparative historical, and then the modern linguistic period. So I'll start with the rationalist period of language study. And that would basically, I'm saying for the sake of this discussion, sometime between 1650 and 1800. And the Enlightenment was characterized by reason, empiricism, naturalism, optimism, and progress, these kinds of ideas. They grew out of some of the developments in the Renaissance and the Reformation, and with human exploration and lots of things like that. But there are some things that are kind of special to the Enlightenment, and some philosophers who speak to it and that I think are worth talking a little bit about. The first one is René Descartes. And Descartes was a mentalist. And so he said that the mind took precedence over anything else. He was a believer in innate ideas, and these innate ideas were responsible for forming into new ideas, and these were independent of sort of outside stimulus, physical stimulus. That's a very important idea, and I'll come back to that near the end of my paper. A second figure is Benedict Spinoza, and he attempted to correct Descartes by trying to reconnect mind and matter, but is probably best known then for the result of a critique of both of them, and radical doubt, skepticism was the result of his thinking. And he was basically a radical critic of the Bible, found inherent contradictions and was emphasized those contradictions. Leibniz, Gottfried Leibniz, he was also very much a person concerned with trying to eliminate ambiguity. And you can see that this would be important in thinking about language that's full of ambiguity. And so Leibniz was concerned with questions of eliminating ambiguity in semantics and tried to affect semantics that did not have ambiguity to it. He talked in terms of his monads. And John Locke was another figure. And basically, he's responsible for empiricism, you know, so this impression or this impress that experiential data puts on the human, and had a kind of a plain sense view of reality. And then finally, I'll mention David Hume, the Scottish philosopher, and who emphasized that sensation took precedence over thought. And so these kinds of thinkers were very important in the Enlightenment. And so you had the rise of such things as rationalism and empiricism, even to the point of skepticism. Language study then during the rationalist period was dominated by philosophers and linguists who approached language from this rationalist perspective. And they demanded that language follow rationalist principles. That meant things like consistency and balance. Historical concerns were there, but most of the time was concerned with kind of a rationalistic system. And so one person, Etienne Bonneau de Condillac, believed that abstract vocabulary, this is quoting R.H. Robbins, developed from earlier individual concrete vocabulary. So trying to account for everything kind of in a rationalist way. You also ended up with the kinds of statements made like by William Jones, the language expert, who was concerned with language relationships, but also finding the best language. And so he thought that Sanskrit, for example, he says, quoting, was more perfect than the Greek, more copious than the Latin, and more exquisitely refined than either. And so he had this idea that you're trying to find some kind of way of judging and evaluating these languages, finding the supreme or most perfect language. And so there's this idea of some kind of a perceived ideal organization and even rational structure to language. There are a number of other people that we could talk about who held to this kind of view. But within grammar studies, the key figure, at least in biblical Greek linguistic study or language study, was the Greek grammarian Georg Benedict Wiener. And Wiener, who lived from 1789 to 1858, probably wrote definitely the most significant grammar sort of the Enlightenment period. And he, in his subtitle to his grammar, originally written in German, it was Greek was said to be the sure basis, sichere Grundlage, for exegesis. And so there was this idea that if you use the Greek and use it in the right way, you could have this certain basis for exegesis. He recognized that he was a rationalist and that he refers to the rational method that he uses. He also uses what is a distinctly empirical approach. He's very explicit about this in the introduction to his work. And as a result, you have some very interesting things in the way Wiener looks at grammar. And so one of those is that he links the tense forms to temporal categories. But of course, he's faced with the fact that it looks like in some cases that in some instances of the usage that they don't conform to these temporal categories. What does he do with that? Well, there's one particular, there are several statements he makes that are somewhat similar. One of them says that strictly and properly speaking, no one of these tenses of Greek can ever stand for another. And so he talks about the present tense form being used for the future in appearance only. So in other words, there's kind of this essentialist rationalist view that if it's called a present tense form, it must be present. If it's used in some other way, it does so in appearance only, because that's not part of the rational system. And so the tense substitution is only an appearance because the label, the logical and rational way of explaining things, must be something else. He also refers to a noun and the true article, he uses this idea of a true article, and the true article indicates certain things. So you can see there's this rationalist set of principles that pervades his look at language. And that would, of course, be necessary if you're intending to use it as the sure basis for exegesis. And in fact, we find some of the rationalist tendencies still present with us. I'll talk a little bit more about some of those in a minute. But I think most elementary New Testament Greek grammars tend to follow rationalistic tendencies. And you can see some of these rationalist tendencies, especially reflected in the way grammar is sometimes presented. And that would be that you have these nice little charts where you have all of these cells in a grid, and there's a demand that each of the cells be filled with something. And if you don't have something to fill that cell, you have to find something that will fit within it. And that tends to reveal the kind of rationalist approach. So it's characterized by this kind of logical, rationalist set of principles, often equated then with trying to produce the kinds of firm results that you think can come from this kind of thinking. Comparative historical period was from around 1800 to 1916. This is the second period, and it was really emphasized. It really emphasized and was influenced by three kinds of movements: idealism, romanticism, and developmentalism. We won't go into it, but Kant had a big influence, you know, this idea there were limits to scientific knowledge. You can't get beyond certain kinds of knowledge. And Hegel came along, of course, was a reaction to Kant in some ways, but also he had some rationalist principles, but he also had ideas of thinking about how knowledge developed and the dialectic kind of approach. But apart from the idealism, romanticism had a big influence. We sometimes equate romanticism with a literary movement, you know, with Wordsworth, Coleridge, people like that. And certainly Coleridge introduced some of the German thought to the English-speaking world. But characteristics of romanticism went further than German idealism in some ways. They were suspicious of reason, and basically then exalted nature, especially what is found in nature. And they recognized reality was larger than the scientific method could encompass. And they had kind of a mixed then relationship with people like Kant. And several key figures in romanticism would be like Schlegel and Schleiermacher. Schleiermacher, very, very important in the field of hermeneutics, often viewed as sort of the founder of hermeneutics. And he had this idea that you could know the mind of the author better than the author, him or herself. And this kind of radical focus on the subject or the internal life of the person. And the third element of this comparative historical period, or big influence on it, besides idealism and romanticism, was developmentalism, especially seen in the philosopher and sociologist or anthropologist Herbert Spencer, who in some ways even preceded and wrote independently of Darwin. And he had a view of a sort of a teleological and positivist way of sort of the world developing. And so the comparative historical approach kind of grew out of this, this environment. And out of this, you, of course, had then the comparative historical approach to language in people like Rask and Grimm, Jacob Grimm, who sort of invented the field of Germanistic, Germanic studies, and some of the kinds of ways of talking about development of language still go back to these people like Rask, but especially Grimm and some of his sound change laws or patterns. Franz Bopp was one of the great comparative grammarians, wrote grammars of comparative work with Sanskrit, Greek, Latin, Persian, German, etc. You have the figure of Wilhelm Humboldt, who's a little bit of a pioneer and actually kind of preceded modern linguistics, had this idea of there was kind of dynamic energy that exists between the speaker and hearer. Some people kind of claim that he's a predecessor of functionalism. Others would see him more in kind of the line of the mentalists and with universal grammar. You have the development of the, you know, the whole Indo-European language scheme. And so the famous kind of a tree diagram where you see all the languages related to each other and you can account for their historical relationships. So very much an emphasis on diachronic study. The comparative historical period arguably reached its culmination in the so-called German new grammarians or Junggrammatiker, people like Karl Brueggemann, Berthold Delbrück. And the new grammarians had this idea that the laws of language change seemed to be without exception, which led to some interesting developments because exceptions really, when they found them, led to development of things like dialectology, ways of accounting for some of these inconsistencies. Interesting to note that one of Brueggemann's students was a person by the name of Ferdinand de Saussure. And Saussure himself was, in fact, one of the new grammarians. And the only book he ever wrote when he was alive, published when he was 21 years old, Saussure was on the vowel change within Indo-European languages, very much within the historical comparative mode. And so within that, you had language origins were a concern. Diachrony took precedence over synchrony. And basically, descriptions of intricate things were based on individual elements. And so there in New Testament Greek, there are still, at least in the English-speaking world, there are still three major grammars that are used. And all three of these grammars follow the comparative historical mode, as, at least as reference grammars go, so far as reference grammars. And these three grammars are the one by Friedrich Blass, originally published in 1896, and then in the fourth edition, Albert de Brunner, the comparative philologian, took over. Blass himself was a classical philologist, but he'd studied comparative philology. He makes that clear in a sort of a preface that he writes to the first edition, 1896, thanking his teacher, August Fick, who was a comparative philologist. So it had an influence on him, definitely. But the grammar was written in 1896, still used widely in its English 1961 translation. But the grammar is, for all of its essentials, pretty much the same grammar now, even though it's in whatever edition it might be, 16th, 17th edition, or whatever it might be, even though it was published in 1896. The second grammar is the grammar by James Hope Moulton. And Moulton studied comparative philology when he was a student at Cambridge and very much wrote in that mode. He's well known for having brought insights into grammar from the Greek documentary papyri for study of the Greek New Testament, wrote his Prolegomena to what was going to be a three-volume grammar, published the first edition of the Prolegomena in 1906, quickly went to a second edition in 1906 and then a third edition in 1908. And then Moulton was working on his second volume of Accidents in Word Formation, and then he was killed in 1917 during the First World War. But he very much wrote within the comparative philological mode. And the third, sort of the culmination of this in New Testament Greek study, is the grammar by A.T. Robertson, the massive grammar by A.T. Robertson that extends to as much as, I think, 1,500 pages. And but the interesting thing to notice about Robertson's grammar is that Robertson knew, originally when he wrote his grammar, he was attempting to revise Wiener's grammar. But when he went to revise Wiener's grammar, he realized that grammatical study had changed. And he says this, he says, he was not going to be able to revise Wiener's grammar because, quote, so much progress had been made in comparative philology and historical grammar since Wiener wrote his great book. And so, in fact, Robertson realizes that he calls the modern period, for him, the modern period, that was the early part of the 20th century, something had changed. And it was no longer the comparative historic, I mean, excuse me, no longer the rationalist, but now the comparative historical model that was in place. And if you check, he has a special bibliography of the works that were most valuable to him, and it's filled with works in comparative philology. And Robertson recognizes this as a linguistic revolution and writes within that mode. And in fact, comparative historical perspective has continued in New Testament Greek study, especially in the intermediate level grammars, which is an interesting thing to note, because you have elementary grammars that are rationalist in approach, and you can see reasons for that. But then you have the intermediate level grammars, besides the reference grammars that I just referred to, tending to follow the comparative historical approach. Now we arrive at the modern linguistic period from 1916 to the present. And there are really three philosophical approaches, I think, that have had major influences on, generally speaking, upon modern linguistics. The first is phenomenology. The second is analytic philosophy, and especially from the Vienna Circle, then that results in logical positivism. And then finally, ordinary language philosophy. And so in phenomenology, Edmund Husserl wrote his Logical Investigations, appeared in 1900, 1901. And I think if we look at this, we can see that the time was right for development of modern linguistics. If you follow Thomas Kuhn's idea of the structure of scientific revolutions, if you see the new grammarians, right, they were claiming that there were these firm laws, but there were exceptions to it. And this follows Kuhn's paradigm shift idea, right, where you have normal science, but they're accumulating inconsistencies until finally something happens that changes so that you have a new paradigm in place. Husserl emphasized our conscious awareness of things, and this knowledge, our knowledge is what is seen or directly experienced. So you have this emphasis on concrete lived experience being socially situated. Very, very important to a lot of schools of thought. And of course, phenomenology was continued in various ways through people like Heidegger, although Husserl and Heidegger kind of had a parting of the ways, Hans-Georg Gadamer, Paul Ricoeur, and even into the existentialists and that mode of thought. A second movement that was influential was analytic philosophy, and especially then as it came to be known in logical positivism. And there was an attempt there to kind of try to justify objective knowledge and basically find a way to have this objective knowledge. And so study of language came to be sort of a sub-discipline of science, of the so-called hard sciences. If you look at the Vienna Circle, many of the founding figures were scientists, hard scientists like physicists, etc. They tried to reduce language to kind of a logical calculus so as to overcome limitations of natural language. And going back to Leibniz's idea of eliminating ambiguity. And it was seen especially then in logical positivism in the English-speaking world. The early Wittgenstein in his Tractatus, of course, had a big influence upon that. And then the third is the ordinary language philosophy movement. And there's kind of a rebellion against the kind of calculus, logical calculus of the Vienna Circle and other analytic philosophers. And again, Wittgenstein had a relationship possibly with that, with his philosophical investigations, where ordinary language, Wittgenstein's language games are talked about, and how that's had an influence in work of people like Paul Grice and J.L. Austin, John Searle, speech act theory and things of that sort. The three major developments in modern linguistics came about, and there are three sort of origins of it. Typically, Saussure is seen as the founder of modern linguistics. To some extent, that's true. He certainly was influential in his lectures that he gave from 1906 to 1911. He never saw them in print, but his students put them in print, and that became his course in general linguistics in English translation, not translated into English, I don't think, until 1959, interestingly enough. And, you know, the kinds of things that came out of this were emphasis on the arbitrary nature of the sign, langue versus parole, synchrony versus diachrony, languages difference, languages system, those kinds of things. And those are very important. But the Prague School of Linguistics also played a large part in the development of what we call linguistic structuralism. And that's seen in the work of, you know, Mathesius himself did work in 1911 on synchrony, but the whole school kind of developed in the late 20s to the 40s with a number of different figures influenced by the Russian formalists, among others. And there was a much more of a social sense of language that came out of the Prague School. And not just a social sense, but also application of linguistics beyond simply language to the arts as well. And then the third group of influential that had an influence on the development of modern linguistics was the study of American native languages. And that was inspired by Humboldt's work and Franz Boas, especially a German who came to North America. One of his students was Edward Sapir, and then Sapir had a student named Worf, and the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis came out of this notion of linguistic determinism, you know, this whole question of how does language relate to thought, and does language determine thought, and to what extent does language determine thought? Well, structuralism then came into being really with the 30s, a hugely influential movement. You see it in lots of different ways within development of language study, various schools of structuralist thought, the Copenhagen School, American descriptivism, lots of different things. SFL, British structuralism came in then to the so-called London School, etc. If I had more time, I could talk a little bit about the post-structuralist revolution, you know, 1966 and Derrida's paper that he gave at Johns Hopkins. And it's worth exploring. And I've talked to others about it, and I present this paper in another venue. The question of post-structuralism arose. And it's interesting because I think post-structuralism is worth considering, although I don't see that it, apart from a few little areas, has had as much influence on linguistic study as it has maybe in some other areas. Derrida, to a large extent, I think, just took Saussure's notion of the arbitrary relation of the sign, the signification, to basically just kind of pulled them apart further. And then you get the notion of deconstruction that comes out of this. One of the areas where post-structuralism has had an influence is in some of the areas of dealing with intertextuality. And so when we come to sort of the recent developments in Greek linguistics and philosophy, there's a lot that can be said. One of the major problems, I think, in a lot of language study, going back to Wiener, is this idea that if you study linguistics, it's going to give you the answer to interpretive questions. You know, this idea of the sure basis for exegesis. I think it tends to come from the view that language is seen as sort of a thing. It's a kind of a static view, and not understanding that language is embedded and intricately involved with forms and formed by culture. And some of these cultural movements, especially philosophically, is what I've tried to emphasize here. The linguist Robert Longacre once made this statement: "I personally do not believe that anybody can work on anything in any field of investigation without a theoretical framework. The I don't make any assumptions man," pardon the language there, he wrote this a long time ago, "is simply a man who works with covert assumptions that he has never bothered to analyze." And so he's countering the kind of positivist streak, I think, that we sometimes find in language study. There are lots of different schools of linguistic thought, and I won't say much about all of those right now. I think there's a convenient way of dividing them into three basic categories. And so you have something like the formalists following Chomsky. You have the cognitive people who basically, I think, are developed from Chomsky in many ways, some of Chomsky, those who objected and fought with against Chomsky. And then you have the functionalists. But what's interesting to note is some of the philosophical influences on some of these schools of thought. And I'll choose two. And with that, I'll bring this to a close. One is Chomsky and formalism. And if you look at Chomsky and formalism, Chomsky has been very clear about this, that he has been influenced by, of all things, René Descartes. And he calls it sort of a Cartesian linguistics. And you can see this in the kind of universalism that Chomsky holds to the universal grammar. It's back to Descartes' idea of innate ideas. there's sort of, this is where Chomsky seems to get his idea that there's this autonomous cognitive faculty or a universal grammar that is there regardless of outside physical stimulus. And even in this case, Chomsky then is sort of claims to be an empiricist. And there is a sense in which he is, but he also kind of has to shift the definition, because whereas most linguists would probably say they're inductive in the way they approach things, you know, they have data and they generalize on the basis of it, Chomsky tends to be more deductive in the sense that he has his notion of the innate ideas, and out of that then comes the particulars. And so there's an influence there of Cartesian linguistics, and he even wrote a book called Cartesian Linguistics. The second school of thought is Halliday's systemic functional linguistics, which grew out of the London School with Firth. And there are two influences, I think, on this. One is social constructivism. And social constructivism is actually a social theory. And basically the idea that, as one sociologist states, that people continuously create through their actions and interactions a shared reality that is experienced as objectively factual and subjectively meaningful. And social constructivism is heavily indebted to phenomenology. And so we're back to phenomenology and its influence by way of a sociologist named Alfred Schutz. And he had a huge influence because I think two of his students were Peter Berger and Thomas Luckman. Although in SFL, it gets less from direct influence of social constructivism and more through the sociologist Basil Bernstein. And then many people will know there's the Marxist influence on Halliday. And in this paper, I just tried to find out a little bit more about what I could about this. And if you look in Halliday's own works, very rarely, he refers to his Marxist view, but very rarely actually cites articles, you know, by Marx or others in it. He does refer to what happened to the linguist Marr, who had this theory of, you know, the sort of an economic base as Halliday describes it, with some kind of a superstructure on top to account for language, but Stalin didn't like that idea. And so that was kind of the end of that, apparently. But Halliday's influence is more of what he would, I guess, call a neo-Marxist view, where he thinks that one of the things that reflects a Marxist approach is, first of all, that Marx really didn't have a theory of semiosis or semiotic systems, but more of a materialist view. And so Halliday's trying to develop this semiotic side. And what he sees that as being important is to look at things like giving value to languages and language varieties, which at that time were not valued either politically or academically. And so he talks about being involved with non-standard dialects, spoken as opposed to written language, et cetera, along those lines, which seems to be a fairly modest influence of Marxism. So to conclude, what are some of the hermeneutical implications of this kind of a survey of philosophy and language? First of all, a lot of it depends on how you define linguistics. And most linguists define language, at least the most common definition I've seen, is, quote, the scientific study of language. But that is really kind of problematic, because in some ways linguistics looks like the hard sciences, but in many other ways it looks like the humanities. And I think some of the philosophical issues really raise questions about what it means to talk about language study as scientific. I think we should revisit that. The second is that the Greek language study has been more widely, I think, there are a number of human-oriented presuppositions here. And so we have to recognize those presuppositions. Even when you look at somebody like Chomsky or the social functional views, they are really focused on trying to think in terms of how this relates to the human being. And so taking the view of language away from being something out there and something more in here or concerned with human interaction, I think would be a worthwhile observation. Third, the view that we should get away from the view that language is a thing. it's not a thing, whatever it is, it's certainly a way of describing various ways how human beings use language, communicate, etc. And we should appreciate what exactly that means when we use it, but also when we study it. And finally, that language is part of the process of description, and that our descriptions of reality come from the viewpoint of the observer, and the language is involved in the observation. And so this idea that's come out that, you know, it's linguistics is really language about language. It's an issue of meta-language, and that the language itself is a part of the process of description. So I apologize for having to move so quickly through, you know, 3.5 centuries of discussion of linguistics with a little bit of philosophy and some other things. But I think one of the concluding statement I'll make is that I'm thankful for the opportunity to have examined some of these issues, because I hope that it helps us to think more about language in terms of it, its relationship to culture, philosophy, hermeneutics, thought, and the human involvement, rather than attempting to make it something other and isolated and objectivist that I think loses out on appreciating some of the most important things about language. Thank you very much.